Hello, and welcome to episode 170 of Dark and Stormy Book Club. It's what we're reading for June. Enjoy.
I'm Ann Dark.
I'm Tracy Stormy.
And I'm Kathy Knight.
And together we are...
It Was a Dark and Stormy Book Club.
A podcast for mystery lovers.
Welcome.
If you enjoy our show, please consider contributing to the Dark and Stormy Patreon. By becoming a patron, you will help us create better and quality content. There are also benefits to becoming a patron, such as exclusive content and Dark and Stormy merchandise. Become a supporter at patreon.com/darkandstormybc. Check our website for the link. We appreciate any and all contributions. Thank you.
Today we have another What We Are Reading episode. We're going to start doing these about once a month. Tracy has the first book.
My first book is Mirrorland by Carol Johnstone. With the startling twists of Gone Girl and the haunting emotional power of Room, Mirrorland is a thrilling work of psychological suspense about twin sisters, the man they both love, and the dark childhood they can't leave behind. Kat lives in Los Angeles, far away from 36 Westrick Road, the imposing Gothic house in Edinburgh where she and the estranged twin sister Elle grew up. As girls, they invented Mirrorland, a dark, imaginary place under the pantry stairs full of pirates and witches and clowns. These days, Kat rarely thinks about the childhood home, or the fact that Elle now lives there with her husband, Ross. But when Elle mysteriously disappears after going out on her sailboat, Kat is forced to return to 36 Westrick Road, which has scarcely changed in 20 years. The grand old house is still full of shadowy corners, and at every turn, Kat finds herself stumbling on the long-held secret and terrifying ghost from the past. Because someone, Elle, has left Kat clues in almost every room, a treasure hunt that leads back to Mirrorland, where she knows the truth lies crouching and waiting. This book is an unreliable narrative to the nth degree. This is the story of Alice, Elle, and Katerina, Kat. They're twin sisters, and they grew up in an old house in Edinburgh, Scotland, where they immerse themselves in a make-believe world called Mirrorland, with witches and swashbuckling pirates. When Kat leaves to go to California, her and her sister don't speak for 12 years. When Elle turns up missing, Kat feels she needs to return. The whole entire time, Kat just thinks, oh, this is one of Elle's tricks. She isn't really missing. There's no foul play. She's just playing games. Since Kat knows all of Elle's hiding places, she starts to look for her. That's when she starts finding clues that maybe it's not what she thinks it is. This house in this book truly is a living, breathing character in this story. The story could not have happened without this house. You had a princess tower, the clown cafe, the Kakadu jungle, and the donk shop. Sounds nice, huh?
Now, were these real things?
No.
Okay.
It's all a make-believe world. Well, this was hiding a much darker secret that Kat was not ready to remember. I guarantee you, nobody who reads this book would foresee the ending of this story. It was so well done. Carol Johnstone, this is a debut book for her. I tell you, it comes from a voice of a more seasoned writer. I really, really enjoyed this book. I cannot wait to see what Carol comes up with next.
Sounds interesting.
Yeah, it was really well done. If you enjoy Gone Girl, you will love this book. Carol Johnstone's award-winning short fiction has appeared in annuals Best of Anthologies in the U.S. and U.K. She lives in Argyll and Bute, Scotland. If you'd like to find out more about her, you can check out caroljohnstone.com.
Sounds like a winner. That's one I'll have to check out. Well, my first book is by a friend of the show, Lee Goldberg. We talked to Lee on episode 99 back in February of 2020 about his first book in this same series called Lost Hills. This book is called Bone Canyon. It is number 2 in his Eve Ronan series. It was released by Thomas and Mercer in January of 2021. There's wildfires in the Santa Monica Mountains in California. Sounds like it came right out of the news,
yeah,
didn't it?
Definitely.
Eve Ronan is the youngest homicide detective in the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. And she proved her mettle in the last book, Lost Hills. She became sort of a celebrity among the newspaper and television news. In the Burt Hills Sheriff's Department, they are a little bit jealous of her. She's gotten a lot of attention being this young, pretty detective. She's called to the scene when someone goes out into their backyard, and of course they're hosing down their house to keep the fires away, and they find a body in their backyard. The body was on a hill above this house. When the fire came and they were fighting the fire, it released this body from its environ and it rolled down the hill. Of course, it's nothing but basically a skeleton. So she has to deal with anthropologists who have to come and set up tents, and they have to find out who this person is. The victim is described as a woman who went missing, I believe, 5 years before. They never could find out what happened to her. She was a young girl. She had come to the police department to report she had been raped. She was known as kind of a party girl, so they brushed her off. Well, she disappeared, and the story was that she had run away. Well, she didn't run away. She was up on that hill all this time.
Oh, goodness.
This is a police procedural. As much as anything else. I mean, it goes into detail of tagging the bones, tagging any evidence that comes up, and what goes into finding evidence.
Remember from his first book, that was a strong factor.
The way Lee writes it, it's enjoyable. It's interesting. It's not dull. Some police procedurals can really get caught into minutiae, and you're tired of it by the time you get to the third chapter. Lee is very talented.
All his years of being a screenwriter, he learned how to take you there.
He puts a lot of human story in with the technical, so it all blends together into a very fast-moving, interesting, well-written book. I like the first book, and I think I even like this one better. It was very, very well done. Lee is really good at sticking in these unpredictable twists, and you think you have it figured out, and bingo, that went out the window. Lee Goldberg, he says he was a ex-Navy SEAL nuclear physicist and professional Daniel Craig impersonator, but that's so his biography would sound a little bit more exciting. In truth, he is a screenwriter. He has written such shows as Spencer for Hire, some Sequest, Diagnosis Murder, Nero Wolf, She-Wolf of London. He even wrote some of R.L. Stine's series for The Nightmare Room.
I just remember Lee Goldberg was one of the most enjoyable interviews we had done that year. Remember, he invited us to his
hotel? Oh, yes.
I definitely encourage you to go back and listen to that interview. It was fun.
It definitely was. And we'll put a link to that in our show notes. He lives in Los Angeles with his wife and daughter, and he still sleeps in his Man from U.N.C.L.E. PJs. The third book in the Eve Ronan series, which I can't wait to read, is called Gated Prey, and that will be released this October. You can find Lee and his books at leegoldberg.com.
I definitely want to read that one.
It really follows up Eve and her personal story from the last book, as well as it puts a little closure on the mystery of the first book.
Oh, really?
I mean, it just kind of wraps everything up from the first book and goes on to the second. So now you need to read the third to wrap up on the second. But don't think it's going to leave you without answers. You will get answers.
Okay. First, I want to take the time to thank Holly Watson of HarperCollins and Bonnie McBird for sending us copies of this book. It is The Three Locks. It's a Sherlock Holmes adventure. A deadly hot September in 1887. A heat wave melts London as Sherlock Holmes and Dr. John Watson are called to action on three new cases. In Whitechapel, a renowned Italian escape artist dies spectacularly on stage during a performance.
Like a Houdini?
Yeah. Emulated in gleaming copper cauldron of his wife's design. In Cambridge, the runaway daughter of a famous don drowns, her long blonde hair tangled in the Jesus lock on the River Cam. And in Baker Street, a malevolent locksmith extracts an unusual price to open a small silver box sent to Watson. From the glow of the London stage to the buzzing Cavendish laboratories in Cambridge, where physicists explore the edges of science of electricity, Holmes and Watson race between the two cities to solve the murders, encountering prevaricating prestidigitators, philandering physicians, and murderous mentalists, all while unlocking secrets which may best be left undisclosed. And one in particular lands very close to home. The Three Locks is a long-awaited prequel to Bonnie McBird's highly acclaimed Sherlock Holmes novels, Art in the Blood, Unquieted Spirits, and The Devil Do. So this is a prequel. I am going to make a very bold statement. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
I have read many interpretations of Conan Doyle's Sherlock.
As I have.
And I have to say, Bonnie McBird's my favorite.
Oh, really?
There were times while reading this that I forgot that it was Bonnie that wrote it. We interviewed Bonnie in episode 104, and that was about a year ago. If you go back and listen to that episode, you will find out what a Sherlock devotee she really is. Yes.
We'll put a link to that episode.
She was a very enjoyable interview. If you remember, we as interviewers could see her in the video. She has so many trinkets. And she has the actual chair that was used in one of the film adaptations. You can see how much she loves, and she lives near Baker Street. So that's how much of a devotee this woman is.
The Devil's Do was such a good book, this book, on my list of to be read. It's one I'm anxiously getting closer to.
The title of it is very clever because there are three stories in this book that involve locks. The first is John Watson receives a mysterious package from his Aunt Elsbeth, which he never even knew existed. It contained a box with a note from his mother to not give him until his 21st birthday. Well, John Watson's 35. It took a little while to get to it.
It's a little late.
Yeah.
Post office wasn't too good back then either, was it?
Well, I think the aunt just put it to the side and kind of forgot about it.
Okay.
Watson takes it around to many locksmiths. It's a very intricate lock. As the story progresses, you're going to find out that, of course, it's going to take Sherlock to be able to know what's in the box.
Goes without saying.
Yes. Then there's a Mrs. Borelli who comes to hire Sherlock. to uncover the truth, the conflict between her